Hello all, this is Dr. Alsip, and we are going to talk about how to locate cranial nerves in numerous different views, including an inferior view of the brain, the actual cranial base with the dura on, and how they exit the skull. And lastly, we're going to talk about a brainstem model so we can get an idea of the origins of these cranial nerves. So let's get started. We are starting with an inferior view of the brain, and hopefully we're getting used to this view at this point. Now, how this was cut, we can only see a few cranial nerves, but let's talk about the ones that we can see. Here, you can see part of the olfactory tracts, which are associated with cranial nerve 1. The olfactory bulbs have been cut on this particular dissection. These are located on the inferior portions of the frontal lobe. So this is the frontal lobes right here. We're looking at an inferior view. They're going to be lateral to the anterior extensions of the anterior cerebral artery, so fairly closely associated with those. Now you can also see a bit of the optic nerves and the optic chiasm right in this region here. These are going to be medial to the anterior cerebral arteries as well as the internal carotid artery. So here's your anterior cerebral, and here are your ICAs or internal carotids. The chiasm is where some fibers from the retina decussate or cross, which is super important for binocular vision. You can see some of the cut oculomotor nerves here closely associated with two arteries, the superior cerebellar, which is the smaller one, and the posterior cerebral, which is going to be the larger one. So any nerve that is between these two arteries, you're going to identify as the oculomotor nerve or cranial nerve 3. You can see a bit of the abducens nerves right here on the inferior surface of the pons. And lastly, at least on this side, on this region right here, you can see the accessory nerve, or cranial nerve 11, ascending from the spinal cord and its close relationship to the posterior inferior cerebellar artery, or pica, which you can see right there. So that nerve that's going to be ascending from the spinal cord is your accessory nerve. All right, so let's work through a few slides showing most of the cranial nerves and how they're actually exiting through the skull. It is important to note in these particular dissections that we're going to see in these next few slides, the dura mater is still present. So the foramina that we are going to talk about will look different, very different than what it would look like on dry bone with the dura removed. So if you see right here, just kind of a hint, this is your jugular foramen. Think about how different that looked on the dry skulls that we have been looking at. So we really need to be able to identify these regions with the dura and without in order to get a good understanding of these areas. So we're going to start anteriorly and move posteriorly. Oops, excuse me. All right, so you can see the optic nerves or portions of the optic nerves right here. So that is going to be cranial nerve 2. They're going to be just superior to your internal carotid arteries or your cut internal carotid arteries right there. You know that the solid structures are going to be nerve because nerves are going to be solid. They're going to be consisting of collections of axons, whereas the artery would not be solid. It would be hollow individual in this dissection because no blood is going to be flowing through. So these are going to be the internal carotid arteries. These are the optic nerves. The oculomotor nerve, so here is one of your oculomotor nerves. This one actually was cut a little bit more distally. So the oculomotor nerve is located on the lateral wall of the cella turcica. And you know you're in that cella turcica region because I can see a little bit of the pituitary gland right here. And also the internal carotid arteries will be closely associated with that region. So these are cranial nerve 3. Same thing over here. All right, both the root of the trigeminal nerve, which you can see clearly here, and you can see a little bit of it over here, As well as the trochlear nerve, or cranial nerve 4, can be found in association with the dura on the petrous part of the temporal bone. Now, the trochlear nerve would be right about here-ish, if present. It is considerably more difficult to locate on a dissection, which makes sense because it is the smallest cranial nerve, so not quite as easy to locate. But you can clearly see the trigeminal nerve right there. All right, moving on, the abducens nerve, or cranial nerve 6, is going to be found on the clivus, or the basilar part of the occipital bone. So here are your two abducens nerves. Now note that this is not where it is exiting the skull. This is just a close relationship to this part of the bone. It will actually exit the skull and head to the orbit via the superior orbital fissure after traversing the lumen of the cavernous sinus on its way to the lateral rectus muscle. So it has quite a ways to go, but this relationship with this basilar part of the occipital bone is something that will help you identify this nerve. The facial and vestibulocochlear nerves will enter the internal acoustic meatus. So I am circling around the internal acoustic meatus. The facial nerve is eventually going to exit the internal acoustic meatus, or the petrous part of the temporal bone, but the vestibulocochlear will head toward the inner ear, so enters this region and never exits. It's really impossible to tell which one is which here, and we wouldn't ask you for that on the practical, but the vestibulocochlear is a little larger, so we've kind of separated on this image. This would be the facial, the smaller one here, and then this kind of collection right here would be vestibulocochlear, or cranial nerve 8. All right, let's identify the last four cranial nerves from this view. Recall that the glossopharyngeal, the vagus, and accessory nerves will exit the skull via the jugular foramen, or the jugular foramina if we're talking about both, with its neighbor, the internal jugular vein. Now, and this jugular foramen is going to be in this region right here. So, like I said, very different than from what it looks like on the dry bone without the dura intact. So similar to what we had at the internal acoustic meatus, it's really difficult to tell which one is which in this region. So we would not ask you to identify the glossopharyngeal or the vagus here because it's really impossible to tell, or it's not as clear. But you can tell which one is the accessory nerve. And this is because the accessory nerve will ascend through the foramen magnum before it heads to the jugular foramen to exit the skull. So if you have a nerve that is traversing both of these foramina, both the foramen magnum and the jugular foramen, you know you're looking at the accessory nerve. Lastly, the hypoglossal nerve will exit through the hypoglossal canals. So with dura still present, it sometimes looks like different nerves, but these are really just accents of the hypoglossal nerve. So these right in this region are both parts of the hypoglossal nerve. So anything deeper in the foramen magnum region, we know we're heading towards the hypoglossal canals, really more superior lateral to the foramen magnum. Lastly, let's look at a brainstem model, as this will give us some good indications of where these cranial nerves will originate from, because most originate from the brainstem. The optic nerve, however, does not originate from the cranial nuclei of the brainstem, but you can see right in this region the optic chiasm, as well as the optic nerves. So this would be cranial nerve 2. Moving to the midbrain region, there are going to be two cranial nerves which will originate here. You will have the oculomotor nerves. So these are both oculomotor nerves right here. This is going to be larger and more oriented towards the midline, whereas the trochlear nerve, these are going to be smaller. And it's really the only cranial nerve that exits the brain dorsally, so you can kind of see it sneaking in from that direction here. So these are your trochlear nerves. Four cranial nerves originate from the pons, and this will be cranial nerves 5, 6, 7, and 8. Six through 8 will be more closely associated with the inferior portions of the pons, very close to the medulla oblongata. Whereas trigeminal is going to be your largest cranial nerve, so fairly distinctive, and its large trunk will be on the lateral sides of the pons here. The abducens will be located right here. They are going to be more medially located, whereas the facial and vestibular cochlear are going to be pretty closely associated. Facial is going to be the smaller one. So this would be facial, and then this larger one right here is going to be the vestibular cochlear, or cranial nerve 8. Cranial nerves 9, 10, and 12 will originate on the medulla oblongata. The glossopharyngeal nerve is the more superiorly located, so this is going to be glossopharyngeal, and this will be the vagus, so vagus and glossopharyngeal are pretty closely associated to one another, whereas the hypoglossal is going to be more medially and inferiorly positioned, so these are going to be the hypoglossal nerves. Lastly, the accessory nerve. We remember this one traditionally was referred to as the spinal accessory. It is going to come off the spinal cord, so inferior to or distal to the medulla oblongata. So this is going to be the accessory. All right, so we have really explored how we are going to identify the cranial nerves in many different views. We will be seeing many of these in close association with their target organs in subsequent sessions to kind of add on to what we know about their origins from this session. I apologize if you've heard any dog barking in the background. Somebody must be delivering a package. But I want to thank you for your time and attention, and always feel free to reach out with any questions.